Miller.
Pledge allegiance. United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
What is your question on the agenda?
Second?
The next select board meeting is Thursday, February 17th, 5:30 here at Fire Hall. Any select board comments, announcements?
I have a comment.
Do you have a comment?
I've been contacted by a citizen who asked what was the final story on the Seacus thing? And I know that we had discussed it, but I got in touch with John, so we can have a more precise delineation of what the outcome was. So the outcome was that all the fines and legal fees have been paid. The DEP has approved and inspected the planting that was done. And in response to a third question from the person who contacted me, there is no pending building permit. And then the next question was, can we stop it if there is one? And the answer is, if the building permit is sought and all the requirements are met, the town of West Bath cannot legally. But not give a building permit. So we can't punish the next person who wants to build on that site, essentially, because of the actions of the person who originally owned the land.
So what were the fees and the penalties and fines?
Well, what they're paying right now, as far as I know, is Sally's bills. So they're paying all of the legal costs associated with complying with the consent agreement.
And were there any penalties and fines? I didn't think we had.
No.
And they also have to maintain the growth for 5 years. Is that correct?
Seven.
And the DEP and our code enforcement officer will be monitoring that.
So as of now, they are in current compliance?
Yes, they're doing what they're expected to do at this point in time.
Okay.
That's the end of my comment. Business item one, broadband task force discussion on next steps.
And we have a task force member here tonight.
Two.
By proxy.
Right.
You're an official.
So it says the task force met last week and would like to simultaneously pursue build up of the unserved section of the mountain road. Any great opportunities available to community broadcast planning?
Well, it's Mountain Road and Birch Point. I believe they were surveying this week, weather permitting, to determine what NJ, who works for Comcast Infinity, stated that they were going to look at both locations. I know parts of Birch Point have internet, but the entire road is not. So we're trying to figure out that as well.
If I can ask a point of clarification, both of those roads include the auxiliary roads, for example, the Poplar Ridge Road that runs off of?
Yes. I mean, if you don't have it at one, you won't have it. And there was actually Harbor Ridge, I believe, had a higher density of
houses
without connectivity.
I speak of one.
But is that not the case?
That is the case.
So that, I actually think exceed the 18 houses per mile, which means, you know, you got to get from point A to point B. I presume that that would work in your favor, but I have not seen the results from their survey yet.
Thank you.
So I think, so we talk about the grants. I would love for Christine to pursue the two grants that we discussed on that call. Presuming that, although I actually believe that Xfinity is going to comply with their build-out plan, but presuming they don't, that would be the next step to help pay for the build-out. Correct?
It's a next step. It's a possibility.
Yeah. And then there was another one that was also about surveying.
Yeah, planning.
So that would help not only determine who has service, but what capacity they're receiving in their home. What are their upload, downloads? Because that may help us better understand what equipment they have. Is it out of date? And certain things like that. So that's another option. And I think that we should pursue all grants possible for that perspective.
So Comcast essentially is not meeting the specification of the contract.
They were unaware that those two roads were not in the contract.
I was unaware of that too. But gosh, one would have thought of it. When they got the contract, they had to check out what the roads were.
Well, they wouldn't. It was actually the select board that approved the build out. Xfinity sent the plan over, and it's the select board approved that they signed off on the roads at that time to approve the contract. The contract was presented to the select board with the map, and those two roads on the outskirts of each side of the town were left off.
I know. Over the years, been surveys done as far as number of houses per mile. Those two roads never met it, but that was years ago.
And he asked when were the houses built? They said there's been houses out there for 40 years.
No, I'm just saying that they have done service in the past, but they didn't meet the requirements.
I believe in 2017 it did, which when the contract was signed.
I have no idea.
We don't have any idea when the last survey.
No.
It's been long.
So he said they're looking at doing it this week or next week. Give us a plan. You know, and what it is, we'll see. Well, I mean, we'll cross that bridge, but I still think, even if, let's say, best case scenario, they pay to run the wire and the cable out to the house, I still think we should pursue a grant to survey capacity. Because if we've got places that aren't getting proper uploads and speeds tied to that, I think it's something that we could pursue with a grant. There's no harm in us doing that, as far as I can see.
Oh, there are grants available.
There are several grants available.
If I could just add to expand on that point, during the task force held us that the meeting you referred to by Zoom, I participated using GradeZone because I'm bonded by Harbor Ridge Road and I can't connect through Comcast. One of the other task force members on Foster Point presumably was using Comcast. This connection was, in fact, I had no access to the meeting. So to your point, it's not just roads like Harbor Ridge or around them, they don't have any Comcast, but the people who have it, not just on the peninsula, but in the rest of the town, may not actually have effective communication or contact. Thank you.
Sometimes it comes and goes.
Like many things in life.
But that you know, that could be tied to equipment, in
correct.
Theory.
Right.
So I don't. That's why I think the survey is important, because I have amazing upload speeds, and I have the latest Comcast modem, which was included in the service. It wasn't a paid upgrade. And Sandra, who's also on the broadband committee, happens to be my neighbor, has horrible service. So I have to presume that it's an equipment component, because I'm getting, and I'm farther off the beaten path than she is. So I think that's the survey element is going to be, I think that's for the town to understand and help residents find resolution to what they have.
Yes and no, the survey is just for this area.
No, it'd be for West Bath.
The whole
town. Because it's not just Birch Point. That proposal goes to the whole community to determine what the status is. And that's a grant. I think we should pursue all the grants, to be frankly honest. I actually move that we should pursue both the grants. pedestrians.
I agree. This is the future. It's just gonna increase and increase. I think we're gonna work more and more from home, whether COVID's here or not. I think that the way of the future is to work from home and kids to do college from home and kids to...
And telehealth and everything else.
Well, presuming tomorrow's a snow day, they can still go to school, you know, and that's one of the elements that they look at. So that's, I think we need to find a way to make sure we service the community.
Yeah, I second that. All in favor?
All right. We may need to do some additional background work, Suzanne, so I'll look at grant specifications and...
Well, and hopefully we receive feedback shortly. That still doesn't take out the grant piece, I think you should pursue the grant piece regardless.
Okay, maybe here's...
Was this survey prompted by citizen input? People asking for this?
The survey was from Xfinity when I asked them to look at the build-out plan.
Okay, so it was generated from the selectmen?
Yes, I called them.
Okay.
Anything else on this particular business item?
Thank you, Rob, for being here tonight.
I appreciate the creation of the task force in the first place. And also, you're correctly pointing out during our meeting that it's not just about making sure that people like myself who don't have Comcast currently, but as Suzanne's also pointed out during this meeting, it's to make sure that everyone who has a connection now that it's optimized, so they can do things like go to business meetings, go to school meetings. So thank you very much.
Get out of here before the snow.
Business item 2, ordinance amendments, schedule public hearing and special town meeting. Now the attorney completed her review of eligible via code amendments, amendments to the table of land uses. All amendments and warrant articles are included for review. A special town meeting is recommended for Thursday, March 3rd at 5:30 at the Fire Hall. A public hearing could be heard on Thursday, February 17th.
Do we only have two?
Yes, but the planning board will schedule the other.
Okay.
Any discussion?
So the actual articles that will be presented at the special town meeting are which ones?
I don't think they've been numbered. They're all in a package.
But the proposal is to include all of the articles that Sally has reviewed and written articles for.
And that doesn't include the signage?
It does include the signage.
It does?
Yes.
Now you don't get how many there are. You don't have to determine which ordinance changes actually go to town meeting. You can wait until after the public hearing, because when you formally set town meeting, you'll approve the warrant, which will have the final articles that you want to present. Does that make sense?
Okay.
So edits may still come?
Right, they're in draft form until after the public hearing.
Okay.
At least one public hearing has to be before the warrant is finalized in case there are changes.
Okay.
And when would the planning board hear it?
That has not been determined yet. Planning board meets Tuesday, so they will hopefully make a determination at that meeting.
Would that normally be, I'm forgetting this, would that normally be before the public hearing or after?
It would probably be after your public hearing.
The public hearing and then the planning board hearing.
Right.
And then the warrant is signed after?
Within 7 days of the town meeting, right?
Right. In theory, you could sign it after your public hearing.
On the 3rd.
Well, town meeting schedule.
It has to be signed. The warrant needs to be signed 7 days prior to town meeting.
Okay.
Okay.
So that takes us to February 24th. Well, the first meeting's on the 17th. So the planning board would have to have their hearing between the 8th and the 24th.
In theory, you could sign it on the 17th at your meeting, which would be held after the public hearing, presuming there are changes.
Presuming the planning board has had their meeting, you just schedule their meeting.
Well, not both meetings have to be before the warrant is signed, only one of them.
So that's the earliest that you would probably sign it.
Okay.
But you have that window.
So planning board has to have their meeting in what window now? For the hearing?
Planning board has to hold their meeting before the 3rd.
Before the 3rd?
Before the 3rd.
Right.
Before the town meeting.
The town meeting.
Right.
And how many days? It is 10 days notice?
And they have to give 2 weeks notice.
Right, but how, is there a deadline between our, the second hearing, which would be our hearing, and the special town meeting?
You can have them at any time.
I mean, you could have yours on the 22nd, and that's still time before.
Yeah, it would be, you would hold yours anytime between the set, the, well, after the select board has theirs, so after the 17th.
So.
Through the town meeting.
The Bath Plan.
That entire window.
West Bath Planning Board meets Tuesday, so the earliest it could be advertised would be the 10th. So we have to give 2 weeks notice, so the earliest that a meeting could be held by the planning board would be the 24th. So that only gives them a 1 week window to
right.
hold town meeting.
Could
right.
When if you
Does everyone follow
so are we setting the date tonight and then advertise? So if we set the date. That's what kind of
yes, you're setting the date.
So if we set the date, as long as we provide 2 weeks notice.
Yes.
So 2 weeks.
Well, no. Town meeting only needs a week's notice to advertise. I'm talking about the window for the planning board to hold their public hearing.
But they need 2 weeks for the hearing.
Correct.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
So.
But we wouldn't set the date for their public hearing. I'm
so the earliest is the earliest. Is 16th, 17th. 18th. Well, so you guys can't meet on the 17th, that's not 2 weeks.
No. The
no.
earliest you could hold your public hearing would be the 25th, because you have to give 2 weeks notice.
What about the selectmen's meeting? That's not ours, it's 2 weeks?
Yes, so remember the email that we sent out asking if we could, if Carly could send the advertisement.
So did you send that
the selectmen's
okay.
public hearing is already advertised.
Okay, that's what I was trying to that's what I was checking, because it's two or 2 weeks from today then. Okay, yep. So the selectmen's hearing is on the 17th?
Yes.
At the meeting?
Before or after the meeting?
And then?
Before the meeting.
So 5 p.m.?
5:30. And then the meeting will immediately follow.
Okay. And then the special town meeting is on the 3rd?
Correct.
And is that a voting thing again, or are you holding a meeting?
It's an open town meeting.
What time?
So.
5:30?
Well, whatever time you decide, but 5:30, 6, whatever you want to do. I think 5:30 probably makes sense.
Yeah. And speaking of the internet, is that going to be available to people online? Or is it totally in person?
Say again?
The voting is in person, but we usually record them so they can watch it later online.
Right.
Okay.
But in order to vote, you would need to be in the room.
Okay.
Are we doing it at the firehouse then, next door?
Like, didn't we decide that we could do it in the bay? If,
yeah, if that's what you want to do, we can
I think we need to
John
prepare for people. It. I think we need to prepare for a crowd.
That's fine.
Yeah, I was thinking hold it in here with the backup plan if it gets to be too many people, move it in there. But we should definitely check with John and make sure that he's prepared for that.
Yep. Okay.
He seemed pretty agreeable to it.
So that would be pretty tough to move all the chairs and stuff, though, wouldn't it? At the last minute.
Well, would they just stand over there?
You only take 5 minutes to move the chairs.
Mm-hmm. We have like 100 chairs, right?
All of us, how many people?
We'll figure
no.
out how to get the chairs over.
No,
if
you have enough.
I think we have to be careful too and respect people's 6-foot distance, and I mean, COVID's pretty rampant, and I think we need to be careful.
Well, you can require masks if you want to.
I don't think that's a bad idea.
No, I think that we need to just keep everybody's health.
Yeah, I'm surprised you're doing it open instead of vote. I thought you would have done it as a vote.
If we do it as a vote, that pushes it out to 60 days, because we have to offer absentee voting. It's a much longer timeline, is what was discussed.
Yeah.
Gotcha. So, I have a question. If you sign it on the 17th, the warrant after your meeting, and then we end up having to have our meeting after that, it's like, and there's public outcry, then what?
They probably won't sign the warrant that night. I think they're probably going to...
We'll probably wait till your meeting. Yeah, we have a window from the time we have that to sign it.
Okay. Did you guys have any questions on the warrants? Did you take a look at?
I think it all makes sense.
Okay. The other thing is that the Board of Appeals has to review it and approve all of the changes, because we're having a special town meeting, which is different than our normal June meeting.
When is that meeting?
Do you want to provide input on that?
So, as Kathy knows, we tried to hold a Board of Appeals meeting. There are 3 members, which is the amount required for a quorum. When we determined a meeting date, one of the members immediately resigned. Another member was unable to attend the meeting after confirming the date. Ashley Randall was that member. She had reviewed it, didn't have any input for changes. She said that it looked fine to go forward. Kathy and I met with Barry Kempson, who is the other remaining member of the Board of Appeals. He had some comments, which I passed on to Christine, but overall, didn't seem to have any issues with it.
So with since one's resigned, we're down to 2, is that sufficient to move forward?
Well, the land use ordinance talks about Board of Appeals review. It doesn't get into the weeds about they have to hold a formal meeting. It does say that they're supposed to submit their opinion on it. So I guess that would be up to the select board to determine if that's sufficient.
So you've received written feedback from
Ashley.
And also
no feedback.
And verbal feedback from the person who actually came to the meeting?
Right.
So you've received feedback from 2 of the 3?
Right.
And they're prepared to go forward?
Yes. The only comment that Barry made that really had anything to do with the ordinance changes is Darlene plugged in a date of March 1st for an effective date. He caught that. Sally changed that to April 1st, so that has been okay.
There was some lighting language that was stricken that he had a question on.
Wasn't there one, there was one word in there instead of, did he want it to be given or changed to is or something?
He wanted that to be changed, but that wasn't part of the presented ordinance change, so that would be more of a clerical change.
So then I move that we have already had our review. Then we've got 2 of the 3, which gives us a majority that we can move forward.
Do we have any changes that need to be made based on those comments?
No. No, because Sally had already made that one change, and that was really the only pertinent change.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we're all set as far as Board of Appeals goes.
Well, are we going to, we have to see, approve that as a board first,
I think.
I just didn't know. Meaning-wise, I just knew that was lingering out there, and that was different than normal, so I wanted to bring it up.
If the 2 functioning members of the board have...
Yeah, we do the best we can with our committee members.
Right.
You know, we can't force people to, do what
they
want to do.
Someone resigns on the day of the meeting.
Right.
Well, I think if you have 5 members and 2 show up, you don't have a quorum. But if you have 2 members and 2 show up, I would think you have a quorum.
Or you can have 3 and 2
just
show up, you still
have a quorum. Correct.
So I think we've met the requirement of a quorum. I think we should.
Is there a requirement anywhere for the number of people on the appeals board.
Yes.
Appeals board is supposed to have 5 members.
Mm-hmm. And we have not.
We have 2.
And trying to get somebody to serve on that board has been very difficult, right? Because people want to have regular meetings, and the appeals board very rarely has any items that they need to meet for, so it frustrates people, I think.
So is there a quirky time, not tonight, at a later date? Is there another function that the board can serve?
The board, the appeals board is very limited in their function, because they're a zoning board of appeals. So they can hear variances, they can hear appeals on decisions of the planning board, they can review ordinance changes. That's about the limit of what they're able to do by law.
So our next question would be, is board of appeals a necessary?
Yes. It's required by state law.
Yeah, so if someone comes to the planning board and they're denied based on doesn't meet the ordinance, they can go to the Board of Appeals to get a variance, maybe.
I get that, but we have only 2 members.
Yeah.
Are they required for the review to have?
Our ordinance is silent on that point.
So are we capable of moving forward?
I believe so. Yes, I'm comfortable moving forward.
But I think going forward too, we need to talk about this Board of Appeals and see if there's someone to get at least 3 members, because
it's important.
Yeah, it has to be.
We're having the same challenges with Board of Assessment Review, frankly. Mm-hmm. It's the same idea. They very seldom meet.
We're not going to get 5.
People don't want to serve.
We might get 3.
In some ways, it's a great committee because it has such a low commitment. The problem is that the people that are willing to serve at such low commitment have a difficult time meeting the meetings. When we had our last Board of Assessment review, I was borderline threatening people to show up to the meeting because it's so crucial.
Karen?
Can these meetings be held via Zoom or telephone? Do they have to be in person? Because the other committee I was on, I got pulled up to Bethel. I was in Miami and I was supposed to be there.
They can be held remotely.
Okay.
Not by phone.
I mean, my life changes minute to minute. My schedule changes. So what?
Right.
You know, if it can be done Zoom or via telephone conversation, that might open it up. And I'm not volunteering.
Well, sadly, spouses of planning board members and select board members cannot be on it. So that is a struggle.
I am not on the planning board or the select board.
No,
but you
have a spouse who is, so that eliminates you.
She's talking about something different than you are.
So a spouse can't do it either?
Correct.
He's going to volunteer
Scott.
Is there a motion on the floor?
No.
Well, there was a motion to, yes, to move that we move forward with the stats that we have and the approval from.
I second that. All in favor?
So is that a motion to move forward with all of these ordinance changes?
And accepting the plan.
Okay, I just wanted it to be clear.
Procedurally, Carly, does the planning board meeting date have to be set by all of us sitting in the same room voting on it?
No, you can email everyone and
take care of it. Maybe we can do it earlier.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, anything that will allow you to get a notice to the paper
sooner.
Because if they don't decide until our meeting on Tuesday, what's the earliest it can be published?
2 weeks.
Two days to get published. So if they decide on a Tuesday, I go in Wednesday morning. And it would be in the paper Friday.
Yeah, we knew this was coming. We just wanted to make sure that everything had gone through legal first.
And for the public hearing, does there have to be a planning board quorum there? Could a representative for the
public hearing?
No.
I can look into it, but I don't think so.
No, could have 3.
We could have 1?
I think then 1.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
saying.
I've never.
She said, looking at the planning.
I've never seen anything about a quorum for a public hearing.
Right, okay.
Yeah, we've never, we've always done it in front of a meeting, so I don't think we've ever run into that.
Right. So something to think about if a couple of you wanna get together and host it.
For the three people that will show up.
Yeah, yeah. Ordinance changes can go with it, it can be passionate, it can be upsetting or.
Okay.
Anybody's gonna be.
Well, people might, my only concern is that people will immediately think this is solar related and they quickly leave when they realize it's not, but that's fine, you know, get the traffic. So, yeah, so I will have my laptop with me this weekend, Darlene, if you get a hold of people earlier, you can crank that out, but yeah.
Town administrators report.
Okay, let's see what we have here. Okay, we had a site visit at Sabina Landing last week. Madeline and Suzanne were able to join. The site meeting was with GEI consultants, and there were about 15 stakeholders that attended the meeting. I heard back from the consultant yesterday. They're still processing the information from the meeting, and they'll send out minutes when they have it. They realize that parking is the most pressing challenge down there. So they looked into the possibility of a grant through Land for Maine's Future that could possibly help the town to purchase property in that area for parking. A letter of intent is required to be submitted by February 28th, and I would like permission to submit that letter of intent. It doesn't mean we'll apply for a grant, but at least it will allow us the opportunity to do that. If in talking to landowners, a parcel becomes available for purchase. So I would need a motion on that one.
I make a motion that we give Christine permission to submit a letter of intent for the grant from the institute.
Second.
Right. Walden Renewables got in contact with the town attorney. They're interested in restarting talks on the solar lease near the transfer station. The reason why they chose not to pursue it was due to delays in the interconnection process with CMP, because there were some issues with, you know, connecting transmission lines to solar projects. I told them to go ahead and restart the process. I thought that would be what you would want to do. And they're awaiting comments from Walden on the most recent iteration of the lease. So that should be moving forward. There was a breakdown in 911 communications a week or two ago. On Rockweed, and I think you all were copied on an email from the Woodworths and the Malters that were concerned about not being responded to when they thought they heard rapid gunfire. I think it was probably actually fireworks. We've been back and forth with Sheriff Mary, who has followed up on it and is working to fix areas in the communication with Saginaw County that caused the issues.
So what was the issue, they say?
Well, it was that when they made the calls, when they called 911, they ended up talking to two different dispatchers, and the two dispatchers weren't communicating. So it was.
But apparently one of them said, I heard the shots, they held the phone out.
yes, that was the first one. And then when they called back, I guess they talked to somebody else. And the deputy ended up not following up due to the feedback that they got from the dispatcher. So Joel is all over it. I just didn't know. Lynn Woodworth wanted me to check in with you to see if you wanted to take any additional action to make sure that doesn't happen again.
Or if we're just going to leave it to... They're already doing that since they dropped the ball to somebody there.
Right. I mean, he knows where the problem is. He doesn't want it to happen again. I don't know if you want to insert yourselves in county issues.
I'm fine letting them resolve it. I don't want to speak for you guys.
I'm fine. I mean, I think they know a lot more about it.
Yeah, I think so too. You'll see you have a budget timeline for FY 2022-2023. The school meetings are in red. All of the meetings will be in this building at 7 p.m. on Thursdays, with the exception of the school board meetings. I believe Emily is going to try to hold those meetings in person unless something changes. Public info session is scheduled for May 17th, which is a Tuesday, and that will be here as well.
So and the 16th and the 17th, are they both here? One's or is a school board meeting at the school?
The school board meetings will be at the school.
Okay.
Unless Emily finds that she needs to hold them remotely. And she's comfortable with having town meeting at the school this year. It'll be on May 24th.
Good.
So if that schedule works for you, we'll take a motion on that as well.
I am not here the week of March 13th.
That's okay.
It's just the first week of May.
Right.
And it's this.
Community agency second draft.
Those typically don't change a whole lot. They have to send something to
in advance.
In writing in advance.
Yep.
What's that?
Request from community agencies.
Yes. Well, it's
an interchangeable walk year to year.
Second draft. See, so March 3rd, see, we have a meeting on the 3rd.
So right. The meeting's following
okay.
The meetings.
Okay. I just want to make sure that we're here.
I think it makes it convenient.
Okay. Yep.
So what we need is a vote on the annual meeting, the public information session. We don't need to approve all the budget meetings. So I move that we set the annual budget town meeting.
I happen to be here the 24th. One second.
Well, I'm going to finish my motion that we have the annual budget town meeting at 6 o'clock at the West Bath School on May 24th.
I'm not going to be here, that's what I'm saying. I'm not here for that. I presume you won't be present.
Change of plans.
I can't. I will be at a meeting May 23rd to the 25th. My other job.
You're the following week, I assume you're...
I'm not doing it around Memorial Day.
Right now, can't do it.
That will not work. We can do it on a Thursday.
If you want to move the public information session up a week, I'm here the week of the 17th. I'm not here the 23rd. I'm not here that week.
What do you mean the week of the 17th?
If you want to move it, so if you move the annual budget meeting to May 17th.
Oh, no, that won't work. We need the time for the town report. We can do May 26th, which is a Thursday, if you wanted to change it. But I don't really want to go any later than that.
No, that's when we usually have it. That is the week we usually have it.
I will be home the 26th.
And we're in Memorial Day.
We're going to the 26th?
That's fine if you want to.
What day of the week is it?
Thursday.
Thursday.
Okay, I'll amend my motion to May 26th at 6 o'clock at the West Bath School.
And I'm just going to put it out there, is that fair to townspeople who may be going away for the weekend to Memorial Day?
Yes, Thursday at 4.
That's a good point.
Is that about us or about the citizens of West Bath?
Yes, usually on Wednesday.
Why are you at the 30th?
Yeah, it's usually on Tuesday.
30th is Memorial Day. I will not be coming to town meeting.
Sorry, I was thinking July.
July is too late to hold town.
I was like, what's the 30th?
No, I take your point, Kathy.
All right, hold on. Selectmen's...
We're meeting on the 17th.
Selectmen's approving the warrant on the 21st. 28th.
Why don't we do the, can we do the public information session right after that?
After what?
Why don't we do, if we're approving the warrant on the 21st, why don't we do the public information session that day?
Because it takes preparation.
Or a week later.
Could do a week later.
We could move that to the 21st.
Yeah.
We could move the information session up to the 12th.
Okay.
I must have missed something. What's wrong with the 17th?
So we can move the
meeting
up to the 17th.
Well, I'm just concerned about the town report.
The 12th gives us 3 weeks to get the town report. It only takes two.
Okay.
So, informational session. Well, information session doesn't have to be a week before town meeting.
No.
Right.
I mean, we could have it on the 17th and then have town meeting on the 19th. Is that too tight? We could do the 12th and the 19th.
That's fine. Yep.
I'm just throwing your numbers here.
Well, that's fine.
That's fine.
I just don't want to push it into the holiday.
No, I agree.
No, and I don't even really want to get into June.
No. So the 12th and 19th work for you?
I think they're doing the 17th and 19th. Are you doing the 12th?
I just threw out a couple dates to give you guys options.
So the 12th would be the information?
Yeah, you could do that, then you don't end up on a Tuesday.
And you have a selectmen's meeting anyway.
So May 12th is public information, and then May 17th is the meeting?
17th or 19th?
Did you say 19th?
Oh.
Either one.
Okay. Ladies' choice.
Since the town's used to having it on a Tuesday, you might want to keep it on a Tuesday.
And what's the day of the Tuesday?
17th.
The 17th. Okay. So, let me amend my motion one more time, so. No, that's okay. We didn't have a second yet, so I didn't amend it. So, I move that the annual budget town meeting be held at 6 o'clock at West Bath School on May 17th, 2022.
Second. All in favor?
I was like, wait a second.
Yeah, it's good that you could plan that far ahead.
I happened to look at that like 2 o'clock today. I don't know why I did that.
And also under correspondence, there's some information about the county's emergency communications project that you might want to read up on. They're doing that with the ARPA funds that the county received. Big project.
So are they going to be able to bring up our code red to a better?
Possibly, yes.
Because that was, it was Mr. Zabarowski's car that was actually stolen by that gentleman sitting right there. And I think that was a huge let down to the Sabino neighborhood when we were not notified of what was going on.
It's something that we can certainly talk to the county about. Unfortunately, the county administrator that started this past June has already resigned. So we're going to get a new county administrator at some point.
I just think that's something that we should definitely look at.
That's a short career.
Yeah. I think it's unfortunate. He's very good.
That's too bad. How long does it take to replace it?
Months. It's going to take months.
That's what I was concerned.
Anything else, Christine?
Nope, that's it tonight.
Any future agenda items?
We talked about our goals at the next meeting.
Business items, board of assessors. Fran?
Zabrowski.
Thank you. Request to combine lots R07-016A and R07-022B.
Do you have information you'd like to present, Fran?
What I'm trying to do is just combine two lots that I bought 20 years ago. For no other reason to satisfy some neighbors that are not understanding.
This one is undeveloped. This is the property.
The roads are, the two properties are across the street from each other. Ron Beal says that for him to be able to combine them, I have to get permission from the board of selectmen to do it. The laws have been changed throughout the years of how to do that, and I couldn't, I'm not a lawyer.
Do you have more than that?
No, I just have one.
But it's not something that was just always accepted to do.
They own this.
Mr. Beal says because there's a road between it, the board is going to have to approve that.
So the section between 22B and 16A is just a road?
Yeah, just a dirt road.
So that's Hope and Vaughn that separates your two lots?
Mm-hmm. Hope and Vaughn road just separates the two lots.
And that's the only thing between them?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, somebody owns the land between it.
So it's my understanding, Darlene, I'm glad you're here. Is that not a requirement if you have abutting parcels?
The law is actually copied for it. Right, copied it for your packet.
Are they abutting lots, or is there a parcel between them?
If they're non-conforming, if they're small, if they're like under. So if the zone is like 3 acres, and they're both like an acre and a half, or they're both like 2 acres, and they're next to each other, and the same person owns both of them, then it's always been that the lot, they had to be combined.
They had to be.
Because they weren't conformed. They were not big enough for the zone in the first place kind of thing. It happens a lot now on the shore with teeny tiny lots.
It's the same idea as Jay's.
No.
Both parcels are over 5 acres. One is developed, one is undeveloped. And the law states.
5 more acres is a key element to that.
Yeah, the law states that for the purpose of establishing the valuation of unimproved acreage in excess of an improved house lot, contiguous parcel, and parcels divided by road, power line, or right-of-way may be valued as one parcel when each parcel is 5 or more acres. The owner gives written consent to the assessor to value the parcels as one parcel, and the owner certifies that the parcels are not held for sale and are not subdivision lots.
So they are contiguous lots, are they not?
They are, based upon the
map.
Yes. They're segmented by a road.
The road runs through them. They're more than, they meet the spec.
specification.
So there isn't a separate lot between them?
To me, it looks like a part, a portion of the lot.
It's Houghton Pond Road is what the site is segmented on. He owns on both sides of Houghton Pond Road. Is that correct? You own on both sides of Houghton Pond Road. There's no other lot in between.
The map is a little misleading to me then.
Yeah.
Attached map.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a line.
So it's really just Houghton Pond Road that segments the land?
Yeah, there's a line in there, I have no idea.
What lots are we looking at?
The lot on the left is a woman's this house. In yellow, and the lot on the right is the other parcel.
Right, and there's the road.
Right there.
And that's Houghton Pond Road in the middle.
Right, so this doesn't, and nobody owns anything from your house?
No, because you can see there's a line. And I think that was from the law survey.
It does look big.
Yeah, the tax map is a little.
That's really where I-95 border is going next, this is the town. So I'm trying to see where, which parcel has, how much land is each, in each one? Oh, 15 acres and 13 acres, so it's a total of 28 acres.
Right.
That's what it's called, okay. Yes.
So this means?
State requirement.
All of the requirements of the state law.
I move that we accept this as it follows the rule in 701A from the state determination to combine parcels.
In favor?
Thank you.
So this is.
No, which one am I supposed to sign this?
Oh, that's not the same. We don't have the abatements.
Where your abatements?
There's a line there.
Yeah, they'll hear from us, Fran, we'll send you something in writing.
Abatement request, I'm assuming that we can just go through this one because it's just a veteran's exception.
Yes, it's a veteran widow's exemption that was missed.
Isn't this the one we just did for $63?
No.
This is the second one that was missed.
Okay. Then I move that we correct that error and grant that abatement.
Can you give me some information on the abatement because I don't have any paperwork? Can I get a name?
Francina P. Roberts.
318 Campbell's Pond Road.
Thank you.
Did you vote?
Did I get a second on that?
You did not.
I second it.
Thank you. All in favor? I'm annoying you, but Susan always messes it up.
I didn't this time. That's not true.
Do we have any other public comments?
Can I ask a question?
Absolutely.
Now,
currently the Marine Resource Committee, do they meet here or do they meet at the town hall?
They meet at town hall.
So theoretically we could have this room on the 21st, the 22nd, the 23rd, or the 24th?
I would have to check with Lisa Moore who schedules the fire hall. Is the 24th on Thursday?
Yep.
I know for sure that that date is available. The 21st is President's Day, so you might not want to have it that day.
It's really only the second Thursday that isn't available right now.
The 10th? Is that the
one?
Okay.
Yeah.
Because I've asked them where she goes works for the hearing, so.
Okay.
I make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
No, I have public comment. I would like to propose a
noise. So when have you been so quiet?
Ordinance addition
in regards to commercial ongoing activities, not construction, not hunting, not fireworks, commercial activities in a rezoned commercial area, which we have quite a bit, that's surrounded by residential homes. This bulletin was prepared, as you can see, by the, it gives recommendations on noise from a, in a commercial area. And it also gives references to noise on certain activities. If you look on one, two, three, on the fourth page, sound level limits in regards to abutters, and this is at the property line. I would like to recommend.
Wait, I'm not following you. I don't see sound level on page.
Turn three pages.
Oh, okay.
This is actually the bulletin that you reviewed when we were talking about the noise one.
Right. Yeah. I would like to propose that the town adopt this as a new ordinance before we get into a problem with commercial development and residential homes in the changed areas, or actually all. I know it doesn't apply to existing. There's nothing we can do about that, but any future commercial activities, I would like to propose that the town adopt.
So is this the state's noise ordinance?
It's not an ordinance.
It's a recommendation. State has no ordinance.
Right.
And it says towns our size typically don't have it, but we also have a lot of land that's been converted from rural residential to commercial use. So there's a lot of rural homes that are potentially abutting commercial development. And this has to deal with the property line decibel readings.
And just to add to that, I know that the planning board, we've talked over the years, because sometimes we have a lot of residents and commercial businesses speckled together along the state road, along the meadows, because of the way the zoning is, it's just so many feet back from the center of the road. And we've had in the past problems with businesses that are open crack of dawn, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, making a lot of noise and that sort of thing. There's nothing in the ordinances to limit like hours of operation for noise for commercial uses or even loud home occupation uses that are speckled in amongst the residences, which has been a problem for a long time. So something in that order also I think needs to be put in there. How do you feel about that?
Wasn't that something that was being considered as part of
the question? Always comes back to enforcement,
right?
But you personally experienced, how do you feel about it?
I think we need to do it, and one of the reasons I feel this way is I'm not picking on anybody, but my understanding is Creekin has had a lot of music, and here we go.
And that's a direct order.
Well, that's why I propose that we actually enact an ordinance, so then we can react to complaints. If we have no ordinance, there's no way to react.
Yeah, and we can hear Casella's at 3:30 in the morning from our house.
Well, if it's something we're going to pursue, we'll need to get Sheriff Mary involved, because we don't have any enforcement.
Well, no. I don't care about the pursuance of it. I'm proposing we enact a noise ordinance and adopt levels, physical levels.
The question is, we don't have a way to.
That comes later. That comes after we adopt these. We have to adopt them first and put them in ordinance. And then we have the option to enforce an ordinance that's in place. Right now, we can't complain.
Well, you can't complain.
You can't, but no action is.
Right.
Yeah, it needs to be something that Sagamore County could enforce.
Right.
So, if we enact something, it needs to be enforceable by
so
somebody.
So they do respond to noise complaints.
Right.
I personally know this. So they do respond already. I don't think we have to
bring anything up. I think they already have a procedure in place, but we have to have, in my opinion, we have to have an ordinance in place to limit future industrial or commercial or what have you.
I just think this is a great idea, and my thought being the whole debacle down to the Seacus line or Seacus or something where all of that's been going on. American Steel could become a huge issue.
Christine, your thought? Can you have a conversation with Joel?
Why is it a county enforcement?
He's the enforcing authority.
We don't have an enforcing body within the town that can enforce the noise complaint.
Then what's the CEO's job?
That's not John's job. No. It's not the code enforcement officer's job to enforce the noise ordinance.
Doesn't code enforcement officer imply
no, it doesn't involve noise.
The code?
It does not involve noise.
So if there was an ordinance saying that quiet hours between 10 o'clock at night and 6 in the morning or something, for businesses, that's not a code enforcement.
John's salary, he's not going to go out at 11 o'clock at night if we have quiet hours.
And we've already discussed this with Joel when we were talking about a noise ordinance previously, and he said that that's something that the county could enforce, but we need to talk to him about how to enforce it and make sure that our ordinance is written in a way that he's able to enforce it. Because they would end up sending deputies out to respond to noise complaints.
Right.
They already do. It's my point.
Right.
We don't have the noise ordinance.
No, we don't.
And I think for future commercial development, I think it would be Lugos as a town to be one step ahead. And I don't believe that tabling it for 6 months or 18 months is going to do us good.
I think it's something that we should look into, you know, creating the language for it. It's going to take some time.
I don't think it can just be commercial, to be honest with you, because another thing that's big in this town is fireworks are a huge issue in this town.
That's already addressed by the state.
Right. It's no
enforcement. We haven't adopted any regulations in town.
No enforcement. And we can.
You can add an extra ordinance to do something about fireworks, but right. Have that, so you can't.
So I'm just, I want to do something.
Okay.
I don't want to do it half-assed. I want to make sure that we cover everything.
There's lots of different pieces to it.
Right. Yep.
I think that there's the commercial business quiet hours for loud businesses. I think that there's the fireworks, there's all that kind of different things that can be addressed.
There is, yeah. I mean, if Trinkins is truly having live music up there, and in the summer it gets to be, so that's all we hear, and we can't sleep at night, it's going to be a huge issue. I mean, we do have a lot, I don't know with the industrial park, is that going to become an issue where people on Sanford Crossing can hear the stuff that's going on in there?
It's been my experience that existing conditions and people moving in around existing conditions, yeah, they may complain, but it's already there. There's nothing from today at whatever time of day it is, the 3rd of February. We can't do anything about that. But
they don't have a license for live music. Right?
Oh,
so there is some things we can do.
Yeah, I wasn't talking about whatever.
Like with Casella's and that banking up there, we can look at their contract.
Mm-hmm.
But that also, it had this ordinance with it had the 7 a.m. to 7 p.m., that would have squashed it in the moment. So I think.
We've been talking about this for a year,
over a year.
I don't want to pick, but where's it at?
Well, it's part of the select board talked about discussing it as part of what we're doing with MCOM.
Right.
You know, when we rewrite our ordinances, we would talk about doing the noise ordinance as well.
Well, yeah, okay.
Certainly
that's
on the radar.
First I've heard of.
Well, we've been we talked about noise ordinances in the past.
Right,
well,
several times.
So back on September 2nd, MCEDD was supposed to address noise ordinances during this selectmen's meeting. Nothing was addressed about it.
Not during the selectmen's meeting. Ken is now in COG, and they're working with us to update our comprehensive plan and the ordinances. That's part of what they will be doing.
Right.
What timeframe are we looking at? I personally would like to see something going for this meeting we just set a date for. If that's impossible.
For the June town, the May town meeting?
If that's impossible, I don't know. I merely brought this up because we already have limits that are recommended by the state. I believe it doesn't need to be telling each and every person exactly what they have to do. But I don't know. I don't know. I guess I'm asking you, is it possible that an ordinance could be set within this next meeting, or is that just?
I mean, time-wise, Darlene, you would start it.
The moment we're McCog, is McCog now?
No. Nate Coach, yeah.
So he's been out. Is he back yet, David?
He'll be at our next meeting.
Okay, so he's been out on medical leave, so he'll be back at the next meeting. So the planning board stuff has not gone to him yet for the ordinances. I don't have any visibility on what the noise ordinance thing is that you guys are doing, so I don't have that on my list to give.
Well, that would be a separate ordinance. That would be a standalone ordinance. It wouldn't be incorporating the land use. Like we have our harbors and waterways ordinance. Right?
Right. Right.
That wouldn't be a land use ordinance?
I think it would need to be in there in some slots if you're going to be talking about new development and that they need to have quiet hours.
It could be referenced and incorporated within it, but it won't be the ordinance because the ordinance that the board has talked about involves a number of different noises.
My concern is the things that we're bringing forth, land ordinance, is going to be pretty smooth sailing. I think this is going to create a lot of excitement and outrage and discussion, and we need to allow the people to have that.
He's talking May, I think, not March.
Not the special. No, I'm talking the regular round meeting.
I think it's doable to get.
To be clear, I'm not talking
to the special
about.
Meeting. No. I'm not against her putting this into the March or the May meeting.
We have a plan, and the plan was to include that with other needed ordinances that would enhance the life of the people of the town as part of the comprehensive plan. And I understand that it may be slow for people, but we have to do, as Kathy says, we need to do it right, and we need to make sure that when we have an ordinance, we can actually enforce it.
Are you opposed, if we can pull this together, to doing it by the May meeting?
I'm opposed to doing anything in too much of a hurry. It gets done as part of the natural process of what's happening with McCog, then fine. But
I don't feel waiting 18 months isn't a need to wait till the next, that's proposed potentially when we have
Do you
all
think
this.
There's the opportunity, Dave, just to ask him at the next meeting what he thinks about this?
Sure.
So it was my plan actually to hijack at the end of the meeting with David to talk to Max about land use ordinance changes and giving that packet separate from the whole comprehensive plan things. We do have a big list.
Yep.
I just don't have more noise ordinance in it because that was Christine's thing. So I'm not opposed to. I mean, we have the language from the state, and it's very clear.
Yeah, it's actually very good.
It is
document.
You know, so if we replicate that into an ordinance, we're following the state's recommendation. It's not like we're creating it. So I don't have a problem even expediting this into the May meeting.
It doesn't take into consideration hours.
It does have hours in there.
It doesn't take into consideration when I'm allowed to put up to shoot off fireworks.
It's 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. There's a specific time lines in this.
7 a.m. to 7 p.m. If I'm going to shoot off my fireworks on the 4th of July, I'm setting them off in darkness instead of sunlight, usually.
It also says the hour can be changed to reflect community values and patterns. As a separation of nighttime to daytime, daytime to nighttime, you already said.
Yeah. And I would think the fireworks would be a yes or a no vote from the town, whether you even have them or don't have them.
Well, it doesn't matter, I mean, it doesn't matter what we think right now. What matters is that it is votable at the town meeting when we have it.
No, I agree.
This is under discussion, it's in the works, and I don't see any need to hurry up and do things badly.
Okay, can I ask the select board, what is an appropriate timeframe that you would assess to get that ordinance?
I would like to really talk to Matt and get his perspective.
Okay.
And Joel, I don't want to tell the city of Perry and say.
Yeah, no, I get you, because I'm not talking about fireworks, I'm not talking about shooting, private gun ranges, I'm not talking about that. My state license allows me to shoot 24/7. I'm talking about commercial industry that affects the abutting neighbors to in that commercial zone.
I think one of the things I want to ask Max, does that make sense to him? Mm-hmm. Or should we tackle this all, everything we want?
Right, and we haven't, on the comp plan committee, he's been out, and I've been lining up everything as the planning board here. We're talking about ordinance changes, and I think that we're going to have that opportunity soon, so it'll get rolling, and we'll see. I don't know, he may tell me that we can tackle some of them on the list for May. He may say there's really no time. I do not know.
And when is he coming in, David? When is the 28th? Planning board puts them on the 28th?
No.
Planning board?
Comp plan.
No.
Comp plan. It's not plan.
Comp plan.
28th.
But is a planning board meeting with him on the 28th? Because each different?
No.
No, I was going to talk to him at the end of the meeting, give him the stuff that we have so he can look at it and assess it, and set a meeting later to talk to us about, because there's a lot to digest. So I was going to give him a packet. So I wasn't really doing it in that meeting so much. Understood. That statement's
made. And I do know that I've already mentioned this, and we've talked about it in a couple of our meetings, and there's been citizens come up, and there's some really strong opinions related to this ordinance.
Mm-hmm. Even though it hasn't been written yet.
I know.
Which way?
So, can I ask, is there a record-keeping procedure for these complaints? Because I know when I have a complaint, I verbalize it and I write it down and sign the data. Do we have any form of record-keeping for complaints? Because if I come up to you on the store and say, I don't like this, I'm complaining to a town official,
it needs to be in writing.
I understand.
Most of these complaints go to Sagatahoc PD. I don't think we even hear them.
So is there a way that we can gather information? Because I understand we need as much correct information as possible, and I think a lot of misinformation is the perception of the noise ordinance. It really isn't.
Something you should ask Joel. Mm-hmm. I think he would be able to give us that information from what he's getting.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's actually a matter of public record.
Right.
Well, I mean, so. But that takes a different, it's a different, maybe I'm reading this differently, do we have a procedure for logging complaints at the town? I mean, we should have a binder. If someone sends something in, we should be keeping a definitive record of it.
Well, we keep records of everything.
But do
files.
But if we have it, if there's complaints,
we have complaint files in our emails.
But it has to be written.
It has to be in paper according to the state law. All complaints have to be held for at least 3 years or until the situation is rectified.
I've complained about Cabela's
$999
and I put it in writing.
Yeah.
Yeah,
see, that's
well, it is
the,
on record in minutes.
In theory, it is. I mean, it is on record.
Yeah. But most people just complain.
I've complained to Gazelle in writing and they never emailed me back, so.
Right, and we won't know how people feel about it until they see the language, and mm-hmm. That's got to be done carefully. That's all I'm saying.
I want to stop my tractor at 5:00 in the morning, I'm going to stop my tractor, and they're not going to stop me. So I know the emotions are pretty high around this issue already.
Well, I guess that's why I keep reiterating, I'm not talking about tractors or hogs or whatever. I'm not talking about that.
Well, I'm talking about construction tractors where they're going out and they have their dump truck and
Actually, the state says that you can't, you know, construction job sites. This isn't construction job site. This is prolonged commercial activity. It's all it is. So it's not the job site. You can't limit somebody from working 4:30 in the morning when it's cool and stop at 1:00 when it gets blistering hot.
If I'm a neighbor and you're building a brand new house and you're doing it 7 days a week and you're stopping up at 4:00 in the morning, I'm going to have complaints.
Yeah.
And that's been part of the problem with research development.
Right. So I think there does need to be more than, unfortunately, some people don't have any common sense
or courtesy.
So you want to include this noise ordinance townwide, correct, is what I'm hearing?
If we can get it passed, yes.
Well, but this even segmented out, it had residential, commercial, industrial, so there may be a way to classify certain areas, and to try and accommodate lifestyle business all in one. We're not trying to silence the community.
Because I, for one, don't know what kind of noise. I don't know any of us do of what American Steel is going to be making over there and what time of night or
they're
not doing much of anything yet.
Yeah, they haven't received their occupancy permits.
But I'm saying when they do, what's that going to look like? Is it going to be an issue for the
neighbors? It's inside. You know, this.
We were told it's going to be really quiet.
Yeah.
But move steel around it. It doesn't seem quiet.
Right.
Yeah.
So again.
Okay. Just officially posing a suggestion.
No,
a
I appreciate it, and I totally agree with you that we need something. I'm just not sure that I want to. I think it's going to be heated, and we need to make sure we do it.
Well, the few meetings that we have had already have been pretty heated. Joel was at one.
But that was actually, I'll say a one-sided, we didn't hear the other side of that meeting that Joel was at.
We will look at close.
Oh, yeah, no, but I'm just saying, but these were the complaints. We didn't hear the rebuttal to that.
I did hear that from several people.
Mm-hmm.
I hope you guys don't think you're going to have the noise rights in this tent, so I know it's going to be.
Mm-hmm.
So I am glad we brought it forward again.
Can I also request that you get information from the Sag County as a matter of public record on noise complaints in West Bath and look at what they actually are?
Can you get that for us?
Yeah. The other thing is, I'll just
thank you.
Say something. Are we ready to do
it? I am.
Is there no more public comment, Harry? Are we good?
I'm good. Thank you.
Try it again.
I make a motion that we adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?